Welcome back to Your Property Empire. Well, joining me on the show tonight is Stuart Waugh, Director of Bell Partners Accountants, and we've just been joined by Charles Tarbey, Chairman and Owner of Century 21 Australasia. Now, we had a couple of similar viewer questions via Facebook this week, and they asked, how high can prices keep going when incomes are not rising in line with that? And how on earth can families afford a house these days? And what does the future look like for families? Mm-hmm. Pretty fair question, I reckon.
It's a very fair question because you always expected those salary increases to move. Whenever somebody came and sat in front of me in my office and said, look, I'm looking for a salary rise, you sort of knew they were up to something. Or if somebody went and bought a house, they'd come and see me for a salary rise after. Or if somebody's wife got pregnant, they'd come and see me for a salary rise.
You're just one of those Father Christmas type of bosses.
I had nothing to do with it too. But, you know, there's still people do come and see you and there's that expectation. But there's absolutely no way I could have kept up in terms of salary increases based on performance against the price increases in some parts of Australia.
But do you think we're actually getting exceptional growth? If you look at it decade after decade and back to our parents' generation stuff, or is it... Because property's always been expensive, hasn't it?
Well, Sydney's... Yes, it has. But when we look at the marketplaces where it's happening most is Sydney. Sydney's become an international city over the last 10, 15, 20 years, even more so. So it's had that incredibly high extra appeal than it used to have. So people want to live here, people want to buy here. And I think also when people do eventually get in the marketplace, like a young couple from 5 years ago who couldn't get in, or maybe even early and did, the last thing they want is for the prices to come down.
Well, now you need over $100 million to buy John's place, don't you? John Simon's place. Because he turned down that $100.
So he turned down $100, didn't he?
It's got to be more than that.
I tried.
But we went to...
I thought $100 would be enough.
Now, Stuart, obviously you're seeing, I guess, people talking about the wages all the time. Is if you're saving money, will you ever catch up? Or is property prices going quicker than most people can ever save?
I would have said that there's always a market for you to get in. However... The old rule is only buy what you live in yourself. So therefore, you're saying, right, well, I only ever live in Sydney. I don't even live where I want to live. So therefore, yes, it's getting further and further away. So it all comes down to our planning now. I think looking at what families' wealth is and what families' availability of putting funds away is getting more and more important. The inheritance and also structuring the inheritance, making sure it comes out the other end the way it should be, is getting more and more important. We can't just like live by what we used to do. We need to be making sure we do all those kind of things right and putting things in the right names, and therefore I'm structuring it that way. I mean, we do retirement planning all the time now and talking about buying properties for the number of children you have. So therefore, if you've got two children, buying two properties, structuring it the right way for tax right now, and then looking at best ways to pass that on down the family later on. So these kind of plans are becoming more and more important, and sitting down and talking about it now is what we need to do.
Yeah. Is the bottom line, there is just no more properties, immigration is bigger and bigger, and so it's supply and demand. So do we blame the governments, do we blame the banks, or is that just the way life is?
I think, unfortunately, that's the way life is, but the banks can have a play in it as well. I was talking to Peter earlier on, Mr. Switzer earlier on about this, and I think one of the issues are the interest rates have been dropped a number of times when there was an expectation that they wouldn't be. The market continued beyond where we thought it would go. Now they're talking about interest rate reductions again because of the economy. Now I think the banks can impose a higher interest rate themselves on investors, which I think they're moving to because they're worried about risk. And I think banks can take a stronger charge in terms of increasing interest rates to hold off buyers, not on business loans, but on property loans. I think they can do something, and that might help it a little bit, move it down.
Now, Stuart, I remember from my parents' days, then they used to say an average price house was maybe three times wages. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the calculations, is interest rates in those days might have been 10 or 15%.
That's right.
Whereas now they say it's, say, seven times, yeah. But our interest rates are a third of the amount. And again, you get the common arguments of saying they also used to live in massive houses and was a quarter acre block, now we're all in units. So is that all part of the calculation?
I think it all is a big part of the calculation. I think living at home for a lot longer is a big part of the calculation. So therefore...
You've just moved out now, haven't you?
Just moved out last year. And I'm actually very happy with that. Mum and Dad miss me. But no, it's not the fact at all. But basically, if you buy a place and you get in kind of some financial trouble, moving back with Mum and Dad is a big option. And as far as having our rents being so close to our interest rates, you can actually get in the market and therefore ride the wave of property increases that we all say we can't miss out on, especially in the markets we're in right now. So getting your foot in the door and saying, right, I'll live with mum and dad for another 2 years to get back on top of your repayments is an option as far as mum and dad, as long as they've got enough room for you. But yeah, so it's basically saying, right, I'm in the market, I can live with it as far as getting someone else to pay the rent for now. And then when I can get back on top of my spending or my lifestyle, I can get back in there myself and rent out a room or whatever it may be.
Yep. Mm. And just as a final thing, Charles, is there any cap on how prices can go? Obviously, we were joking about John Simon's place at 100 million, but look, maybe that's 200 million. And if you're a billionaire, it's cheap as chips compared to London.
It is all relative. And you wonder about whether or not London or New York or Hong Kong, which city is the best of where you want to live? And I know a lot of people love this particular city. And so I think there isn't a limit, but Chris, there are properties that people can still buy for mid fives in Sydney. They look around the suburbs. The suburbs they probably don't want to live in. That's all I can say about that, you know.
Now, for more ideas on investing in property and how to see how you can maybe afford a property, you can always download a copy of my book for free. Just go to yourempire.com.au. And we love getting the questions either on Facebook, Twitter, or on email. And just send us your details to chris@yourempire.com.au. Now, Charles, Australia.